Hello, and welcome to Talk the Walk. I'm Azam Khan. There are over 400,000 migrant workers in Hong Kong, vast majority women, and from Southeast Asia. In many ways, they are the backbone of the city's economy, with many decades of roots to the city. Each migrant group is a tight-knit community with connections back home, and often rely on NGOs to help them navigate through services and rights available to them in the city. My guest today is the founder of Pangyao, a Hong Kong-based multimedia social platform dedicated to being a one-stop shop for migrants in Hong Kong for all aspects of life. She also has her own radio show on RTHK called Pinoy Life. Aileen Alonzo Hayward, thanks so much for taking the time to speak with me.
Thank you so much, Azam.
Can you talk a little bit about the platform and its mission and how you guys connect with the community in Hong Kong?
Sure. So Pangyao, we started, it was born out of, as you mentioned earlier, I have a radio show at RTHK. And there was a lack of resources for migrant domestic workers that I've noticed. It was until my friend and ex-bandmate, Martin Turner, so he approached me and said that I'm planning on doing a website, making a website. Can you give me any details about the migrant worker community? Because you're the one who works closely with them. Is there anything that you think we can build? And then I said, funny you ask that, because it has been a long time since I've always wondered, why can't there be like an aggregator of everything about the aspects of migrant worker life? And so that's how Pangyao was started, was through the website that Martin built. And then we put together, if you go to the website, we have NGOs, government listings, different departments, Philippine departments, government departments, Hong Kong government departments are listed there. So if you're a migrant in Hong Kong and you want to look for information, you go to pangyao.hk.
And a lot of, to my understanding, a lot of overseas workers here are very active on social media and ask for a source of news, and even during COVID times as well, for them to sort of navigate through the information that was available. So could you share a little bit about how you tap into that aspect, that importance for them to be able to reach out to them?
Social media has been a big help with us in Pangyao, just spreading the word about us. And as you mentioned, Filipinos are very much into social media, and I guess a lot of Asians are. So we started, as soon as we started our website, we opened a Facebook group page, and that just skyrocketed. So it's only more than 2 years old, and already we have 70,000 followers, and it's growing so much. Every week we have anywhere between 500 to 1,000 new members, so it's been really phenomenal.
How do you strike the balance between the digital and the physical? I believe you're the only print lifestyle magazine that caters to the migrant worker community in Hong Kong.
That's right, yeah, because during COVID times, there were several Filipino publications and Indonesian publications, but they stopped print during COVID because of the lack of advertising. So that's when we thought that, because we're self-funded and it's just me and Martin in the beginning, so there was only two of us, so we didn't have a lot of overhead. And so we said, why don't we try and do a print magazine in the middle of the pandemic, just so that there's something that we can offer into the community. And so we got the help from a friend of ours. His name is Steve Elil, and he works for Cedar Hong Kong. And they do a lot of in-flight magazines for Cathay Pacific, for British Airways. And so during the pandemic, they also suffered because there's not a lot of flights anymore. They also didn't have a lot of advertising. So they decided to help us pro bono to design a whole magazine that, to our taste, and you know, we collaborated together. And so through our friend Steve, he helped us build the magazine and just make it really pretty, because we also don't have any print experience between me and Martin. So it was good that we had the help.
That's incredible, because a lot of new media outlets, when they start now, print is not necessarily what they go, you know, they don't want to go through the hassle and the headaches of doing that. So can you talk a little bit about what that experience has been like, the benefit, has it reached out to more people?
It's been a real uphill journey. We are 7 issues in the magazine, so we're only 7 issues, and we publish it every 2 months. So the learning curve has been really steep, because neither Martin nor I, we don't have any print magazine or print journalism experience. And then But because of the help of a lot of our friends and a lot of people we know in the print journalism sphere, for example, my husband, Darren, he works for the New York Times and he's their design editor. Mm. So he's also a big help in the beginning for us.
That was really great help.
And then we have more friends from SCMP, Rob G and Rob B. They helped us with the editing in the beginning. And it was really great having friends who also believe in the cause that we were trying to do.
How much do you cater to to those people back in those regions for family members who like to keep in touch of what's going on in Hong Kong for the family members that are here? Is that something you guys also keep in mind?
It wouldn't be out of our... We wouldn't say no.
Rule it out.
Yes, we won't rule it out. But for now, we are trying to build our Hong Kong reach. Because at the moment, our print we print around 5,000 to 6,000 copies every 2 months. But the demand is so much higher.
That's a lot.
We can give out, we can give as many, as much as like 500,000.
Right.
Just because of how big the ethnic minority and the domestic worker community, the migrant worker community, not just domestic workers, like all the other ethnic minorities. So we can definitely give out more.
Yeah.
And that is our... goal for now is to increase our reach in Hong Kong and try to share more stories.
And Hong Kong is still a newspaper reading, magazine reading society, would you say?
Yes. Everyone who we hand the magazines out, they go like, wow, this is great. And it's something, and it's free.
Right.
So people really take it. We put them in coffee shops, we put them in restaurants who would want to listen to us and go like, can we please put it here?
Yeah.
And then, you know, that's great. So we try and reach out to more distribution points.
So you guys do a lot of different engaging sort of creative soft topic content. How do you strike that balance between the content that you produce, whether it's a creative or to educate the minority group here with what services are available here? So how do you guys strike that balance?
For our magazine and platform, Martin and I decided in the beginning that we wanted it to be less about their life as migrant workers in Hong Kong and more about the culture. Whether you're Filipino or Indonesian or Sri Lankan or where your home country is, what we want the platform to be is to be a showcase for where you're from and what your culture is. So they can post photographs there, they can post selfies, they can post anything in the blog section, they can post recipes, their little love stories or stories about heartbreak, their stories about their employment in Hong Kong.
Yeah.
So you can find that all under blogs or under the poetry section. So we've consciously made it not about work.
Right.
So there's not a lot of employment agencies listed in the website itself, because we want them to go to our platform as a safe space for them, and not it's
sense.
not okay, I'm going to go to Pangyao because I'm going to look up work. Or
can you talk a little bit about, because you guys started in 2019, correct?
Yes, that's right.
So it was just before COVID hit. So could you just talk about that sort of experience? So when you guys started and then COVID hit, and did that sort of add a new layer to your mission here, or add a new new thoughts to what you guys were trying to do?
COVID gave us time to slow down a little bit. Like I said, we didn't have a lot of advertisers in the beginning, so everything was self-funded. And during COVID, we also had a lot of people helping us because for their work, they also can work from home, so they had a bit more time to help us. And during COVID, it was also a time for us to gather our thoughts and like, okay, once everything opens up, which we didn't expect it to be 2.5 years later.
Right, of course.
It took longer than we anticipated, but it gave us time to kind of line up things for the magazine, like content, advertising, government departments that we need to reach out to, NGOs. We spent a lot of the first year visiting people and having meetings with them, organizations, community groups. We've talked to so many people in the first year and a half.
But there was also such a disproportionate impact to the migrant community here, the pandemic. So could you talk about a little bit of that experience? Did that also change you guys' mission or impact you guys at all?
Oh, yes, very much. During the pandemic, it was hard for everyone. And migrant workers felt it a bit more because they're not in their own homes, they're not with their family, they're far away, so they have to deal with not only the stress of work, but also the stress of being lonely or being homesick. And also, most of them didn't get any chance to have days off, because even though it was said by the Labor Department that, oh, you have to let your domestic worker have their day off, they just have to be careful because it was in the middle of the pandemic, but still there were a lot of domestic workers who were not allowed to go out of the house, so they also didn't have downtime to themselves. So it was a mental health crisis that was waiting to happen. And so through our Facebook group, we could really see how many people were struggling with it, how many domestic workers were trying to reach out. And because it's a free Facebook group, so you can post questions, you can post your own stories. We do have some moderators just to make sure the content is PG and it's all wholesome. But you can see that a lot of them have been struggling during the pandemic. And then it all came to a head during the, there was the big second wave of COVID. And then that was the time when there were a few domestic workers who were terminated on the spot by their employers, and they were homeless out in the street with everything they had, like with their rucksacks and their suitcases. And so this is where the Migrant Domestic Worker Coalition was born. So to start, there were about 14 different NGOs, charities, organizations, and that's including us, Pangyao. It was pulled through together by Catherine. She's the CEO of Pathfinders, and she connected all the different NGOs who deal with migrant domestic workers in order to help domestic workers during this crisis, because it was a crisis. Right. Where could they go? Who could help them? Even hospitals couldn't take them because they were full. Mm-hmm. So we all came together and had weekly meetings. Right. And in the beginning, it was more often because we had to come up with solutions. Like, okay, who should approach? For example, there is this NGO called Splash, and they help domestic workers with swimming lessons, which in turn helps their own well-being, like mental health,
sure,
physical health. Mm. So they suggested, like, oh, maybe we can approach Decathlon. Maybe they can donate some tents to temporarily shelter domestic workers. So it was amazing to see how quickly all these different organizations who normally work independently of each other
come together. Right.
So that was great.
That's awesome. I'm going to pause you right there while we take a quick break.
Yes.
Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back with Aileen Alonzo Hayward. Stay tuned. Welcome back to Talk the Walk. I'm speaking with Aileen Alonzo Hayward, founder of Hong Kong-based media platform Pangyao. Ms. Alonzo Hayward, you were mentioning before about how the pandemic sort of forced a lot of the different groups and entities in the that cater to the migrant communities to come together and consolidate the community bonds. Can you speak a little bit about the importance of community building aspect to tackling issues such as the issues that you guys focus on?
Yeah, so after the whole crisis during COVID, the coalition, we call MDW, which is Migrant Domestic Worker Coalition, we still continue to communicate to each other and focus on different aspects of the community that needs help. Sometimes it would be either to call for donations if there's a need, or sometimes it is to discuss about what would happen if the Hong Kong government needed some opinions, or they sometimes ask for public opinion about legislation about domestic workers, for example, the working hours, or trying to renew the terms of the employment contract. So there have been talks about that as well. Right. And So we try to come together and then talk about different issues that we can.
So it's a larger voice then when you guys are together and you're able to speak and give advice to the government about different.
Yeah, and that's more from the NGO side more than Pangyao side,
right,
because
right.
For us, we help them share the information. We help disseminate the information through our own media contacts. Basically, through Pangyao, we listen to them and we let the NGOs and the charities and the people who are in the community groups themselves, because they are more in touch with what the needs are. And so, yes, we help them by sharing that information.
You mentioned that you focus on giving them a safe space and to be able to engage in the arts and the music and with food. I know you guys do that as well. And so, like, different recipes and stuff. So can you just speak a little bit about how that's a big part of what you, the content that you guys create?
So for our softer topics, which I think we do quite a lot on the magazine and on the website and digitally and on Facebook, we like to give them a chance to also tell their own stories. For example, we have a part of the magazine called Taste of Home, which is recipes, but not just a recipe, but a personal story of every person who makes the dish. So if we feature somebody from, say, we had somebody from Thailand cook a special dish from her home country, so we would feature the story behind it. Why does she like making it? How did she learn how to make it? And then we put the recipe down.
Okay.
And so we think that these kinds of stories help other people connect with different cultures, not just the Filipino community,
right,
and not just the Filipino culture.
And you yourself come from a musical background. You know, you, from my understanding, that you played music before in Hong Kong, or still do.
During the pandemic, there hasn't been any live music at all for 2 years. So that was a big blow also to a lot of musicians in Hong Kong. But my experience as a musician, so I've been playing music in Hong Kong, I would say maybe 15 years now, has been great. Filipinos, we love music. We do karaoke, we play guitar all the time, and it's a lot of singing and dancing. And that's how we share stories most of the time.
And that's the constant thread, because you've worked in finance before, then you entered the media space and you have your radio show, the award-winning, very successful radio show, but the music has been the constant theme throughout that whole time? You've been playing music in Hong Kong throughout that whole time?
Yes, as much as I can, yes, I would. So I also write my own songs, and I had that band, Martin Turner, who is the co-founder of Pangyao, so we used to be in a band together.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so that also helped us with Pangyao as well, because we already know, we were already friends before then, so we kind of had the same wavelength in terms of how we would help the community, and it was also through music.
Can you speak a little bit about you growing up in Hong Kong? Because for me, it seems like a very poetic full circle, your journey of, you know, growing up here and then working in different spaces, and now almost like a calling where you're helping people from your community in Hong Kong here to be able to have a better life. So can you speak a little bit about that journey?
Yeah, so I have a little full circle story. I'll try to make it very brief. So I was born and raised in Hong Kong, and my mom was a domestic worker, one of the first domestic workers in Hong Kong. She came here in the mid-70s, and back then, domestic workers still had a choice to become Hong Kong residents, so hence me and my family are here. Which is no longer in the law anymore. So if you're domestic workers, you're not allowed to become a Hong Kong resident. But back in the day, so my mom was one of the first domestic workers. And while she was pregnant with me, she loved listening to the radio. She would always listen to Radio 3. And she had a favorite presenter whose name was Aileen Bridgewater. And so she always tuned into her. She had some murder mysteries, I think, that was really famous in the 80s here in Hong Kong. And then my mom was just super glued to her show. And so she named me after her favorite presenter. And then I didn't know this when I started working for Radio 3. But then when I told my mom that, I said, oh, guess what? I'm leaving banking and I'm going to work for RTHK Radio 3. And she was so
ecstatic.
She just, she screamed a little bit. She said, do you know where your name came from? It came from one of my favorite presenters from RTHK Radio 3.
And you had no idea.
I had no idea. And I said, No way.
And she said, I forgot to tell you that.
Yeah, so she said her name is Aileen Bridgewater. And so I started to ask my producer there, like, oh, do you know Aileen Bridgewater? And he said, yes, but sadly she passed away 3 months ago. And so it was like, okay, so I'm starting and she just passed away. And so I didn't even get to meet her. And they were like, that's an amazing story.
Right. So, wow, that's incredible. And then after working in finance, then you got an opportunity to go into the media space and start what you now continue running 10 years on, Pinoy Life?
Yes, so Pinoy Life is my baby, and it's a 10-year anniversary this year, 2023. And when I started the radio show, I had no experience in journalism at all. My only experience in connecting with people and being in front of people and talking to people was through my music. And it was also through there that I got the radio show. So one of my friends, her name is Chris B, and she runs the Hong Kong Underground, which is like a platform for indie musicians in Hong Kong. So she was the one who approached me and said, do you speak Filipino? And I said, yes. And she said, Radio 3 are looking for somebody to run their Filipino show. And I said, that's great, but I have no idea how to run a radio show. And she said, you'll be fine. You know, you just talk to people like how you naturally do. And so I went in, did an audition, recorded a show, and then talked to the producers. And then they said that, can you please run the show for us?
Right.
I said, you have to show me the ropes.
So the combination of both the music scene and what you've done there and the radio show, it really helps you keep a finger on the societal pulses, right? Especially particularly with the migrant workers here.
It helped a lot just because I already had connections in the Filipino community through my radio show. Mm-hmm. So the Philippine Consulate General goes on my show every week.
Oh, wow.
Different departments.
Right.
So it's such a big department.
Yeah.
So we have the cultural section, we have the social welfare section, the legal section, the public housing loan section. So all these different sections, they go on my show every week. So I give them 15 to 20 minutes of my show so that they can talk about what their section is, if there's any questions from any of my listeners. And so I've built that connection with them, and then I built a huge connection with community groups.
Right.
So there are hundreds of community groups just in the Filipino domestic worker community.
Right.
Because if you're from this island in the Philippines, they have their own group. If it's a different speaking language, they have their own group. If it's like a martial arts group, they have their own community group.
Right.
And the LGBT community, they have their own group. So I've built connections with them by just going on Facebook and then looking at different connections and saying that, okay, I just message them and say, hi, I'd like to connect with your group or give your group a bit of a platform or somewhere to share your voice. And they're like, okay. And so I've built a lot of friendships with community leaders.
What's next for Pangyao and your guys' mission for now that the Hong Kong's opened back up now? So for 2023, what's the outlook for you guys? What are some things you want to focus more on or to build more on?
So for 2023, we're looking to have more. We always need sponsors and advertisers to help us grow our print copies. Like I said, we at the moment we only print 5,000 to 6,000 copies every 2 months. We would like to expand on that a bit more, and then we are in talks with some government departments so that they can get pages from our magazine. We have one from the Department of Tourism with the Philippines, and also the Philippine Consulate General, he always has a page reserved on our magazine so he can give out his message to the migrant community. And we've also featured the Equal Opportunities Commission here in Hong Kong. So we are in collaboration with them as well. They've been on our magazine. And then we're also in talks with hopefully the Department of Labor and all the other departments that get in touch with the migrant community.
Aileen Alonzo Hayward, thank you so much for taking the time to speak with me.
Thank you very much for having me here.
Thanks for joining us, and I'll see you next time. Goodbye.